The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Keep silence. Keep silence before him. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, we are so thankful, dear Lord, for all the blessings that you bestow in our lives. We thank you, dear Lord, for the Sabbath day that you have given to us, where we can assemble, we can convocate, dear Lord, for holy worship and for fellowship. Pray, the Lord, that the worship that we have now, that it may be acceptable before thy eyes, that you may bless us by thy spirit, we pray for Christ's sake. Amen.
The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Numbers 6, verse 24 to 26. At this time, let us turn to hymn number 21. Let us rise and sing, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Hymn number 21.
Hymn number 21.
Immortal, invisible, God only wise. Enlightened, accessible, hid from our eyes. Most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days. O mighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Unresting, unhasting, and silent as light. Nor wanting, nor wasting, thou rulest in might. Thy justice like mountains high soaring above. Thy clouds which are fountains of goodness and love. To all life thou givest, to both great and small. In all life thou livest, the true life of all. We blossom and flourish like leaves on the tree, then wither and perish, but not change and be. Great Father of glory, pure Father of light, thine angels adore thee, all veiling their sight. O Lord, we would render, O help us to see, 'tis only the splendor of light hideth thee.
You may be seated.
At this time, we're going to have our sharing by Brother Ernesto.
Good morning and happy Sabbath.
Morning, happy Sabbath.
This sharing always impresses me because sharing time, actually, because part of sharing is sharing the time. So I don't feel like 5 minutes is enough for me to share. We'll do our best. It's interesting how I've been studying the seven churches, and I'm up to the Church of Philadelphia, and the Church of Philadelphia is defined as brotherly love. So what I'm going to read is from the medical missionary and it's titled The Orphan's Home. And so it starts out by saying, those who have the good things of this life, were they unselfish? And so we can agree that we have the good things of this life. At least me, for myself, I could say that. You know, I know a lot of people that are going without. I know personally a gentleman who I often present in prayer, that his name is Ricardo, that he says that he claims to be homeless and he goes without eating sometimes. So my reading is coupled to a testimony that what happened to me sometime starting the previous week, and it went in off into this week. But it says, those who have the good things of this life, were they unselfish? That's pertaining to me and, you know, those of us that experience selfishness in some way or form, you know? Not necessarily the way that people say or would judge us, but, you know, we experience selfishness at times. Because what happened to me was that I was sitting with my son 2 weeks ago. I went into this restaurant to buy food for my son, this Dominican place, and here comes Ricardo. Darian had paid for his own food. Here comes Ricardo, who's homeless. He's a drug addict, and he was hungry. And he's like, oh, how you doing? You gonna buy me a plate of food? And I said, no. I just, you know, I'm in a rush. I just came out of here. My son bought his own food. I said, I'll see you there. Oh, boy, that ate me up. Every time I knelt down to pray, I'm thinking about this guy. Not only praying for him, because I pray for him every day, but overwhelmed with the thought that I rejected this guy a plate of food. I stopped thinking about him. And so this week, I come home and my son is like, I'm hungry. And he makes something to eat for himself. I'm like, I gotta go. And when I came back, he has the heated stuff on his plate. And I'm like, can I get a piece? And he said, no. And I was like, whoa, man. You know, here's my experience with what I did to Ricardo, staring me in the face. And so so then what happens is me and Darian go over to this place again, and we're sitting down and eating this time. And here comes in Ricardo, and he's like, I've been thinking about you. And I said, oh, sit down, I got a plate of food for you. So I got to redeem myself. And it's amazing what this guy started saying to my son. I said, have a seat. And he sat down next to my son, and he started saying to my son, you know, you should appreciate your father because he has a quality that not many people have. I'm like a piece of garbage to most people on the street because I'm homeless, you know? But this guy has a quality that God has put in his heart because he treats me like a person. I had to look away and to keep from crying because the guy was talking about Jesus. I said, oh, praise God. That's not me you're looking at, that's God. And I said, I got to confess to him that I couldn't stop thinking about the fact that I denied a plate of food. So now that my 5 minutes are up, I'll read. Those who have the good things of this life, were they unselfish, were they Christ-like, would feel it a solemn duty to help struggling ones in their time of perplexity, want, and bereavement. The Lord has placed in the hands of his agents here upon earth sufficient to help the needy, so that if each of his agents would work unselfishly as Christ worked, none need suffer for the necessities of life, nor would any be left to hunger for words of tender sympathy. But selfishness and pride say, pass them by. If you attempt to help all, you will have your hands full and your hearts full. Hearts full of what? Of the pitying love and tender human kindness and sympathy of Christ? Is not this fullness far more desirable than the heart full of self-love, self-caring, self-exaltation? Let the mind of Christ become your mind, and the works of Christ become your works. And then you will keep the fast that Isaiah describes. Is not this the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens? Find out, that's Isaiah 58, 6 and 7. Find out what the poor and suffering are in need of. And then in love and tenderness, help them to courage and hope and confidence by sharing with them the good things that God has given you. Thus you will be doing the very work that the Lord means you to do. Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thine house? I'll leave it at that. Thanks for letting me share.
Okay. Everybody smiling with tears in their eyes? Okay. Thank you for the sharing. At this time, we're going to have a change of story. This story comes from the book of Judges, Judges chapter 7, and we're going to read from verse 13. It says, "And when Gideon was come, behold, there was a man that told a dream unto his fellow, and said, Behold, I dream a dream, and lo, a cake of barley bread tumbled into the house of Midian, and came unto a tent, and smote it, that it fell, and overturned it, that the tent lay alone. And this fellow answered and said, This is nothing else save the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, a man of Israel, for into his hand had God delivered Midian and all his hosts. And it was so, when Gideon heard the telling of the dream and the interpretation thereof, that he worshipped and returned into the host of Israel and said, Arise, for the Lord has delivered into your hand the host of Midian." You remember that story? Right? Where was Gideon at this time? What was he doing? He was near the camp of the Midianites, right? And what he was doing? He was listening, right? And he heard whose voice? Whose voice did he hear? Well, he heard the man's voice, of course, right? Because he's the one talking. But who was giving him those words? God. And did Midian recognize that? Yes, he did. He heard the voice. It wasn't God's voice, but through him, God was speaking. And so that's very interesting. Do you, anybody here like to talk? Yes. Everybody likes to talk, right? How many like to listen? Everybody likes to listen. Obedience is something else, so. Well, you obey, but everybody likes to listen, right? Don't you like to listen to your parents, to your friends, to your family, people you talk to every day? When they call on the phone, do you ask, who is this? When your parents call, do you say, who is this? I'm your father. Oh, okay. Do you ask your father who he is? How about your mother? Do you ask your mother who she is? How about grandma? About your family members. Why is it that you can hear their voice over the phone and recognize their voice? Why? You're used to their voice. You spend time with them, right? You talk to them every day. They know your voice, you know their voice. Yeah. It's very interesting. I was watching this documentary and all these penguins in Antarctica walking. And then, you know, the female penguins come back and they call in the babies. And I'm like, how can they tell the penguins? They all look alike. How can they tell? I can't tell female or male, you know. But they come and they give their cry and here comes the father with the baby. I'm like, man, that's amazing. They all look alike. They have the swimming suit on, right? But everybody likes to talk. And people recognize the voices that they're used to every day. You know that people can recognize voices over the phone. And even when the person is sick, oh, you don't sound like too, but you still recognize that voice. Even a whisper. You like whispering? Yeah. I used to like to whisper. I don't know if this happened to you, but I would like to whisper secrets. You ever done that? Whisper a secret? To who? To Nathan? No, because he's the secret about, right? But who you whisper secrets to? Your friends? Maybe your mother, your father? You don't want to get in trouble, right? But it's okay. You can whisper. You know, whispering takes a lot of work, more than talking. But whispering is very unique. Everybody likes to listen. I used to just, sometimes I had nothing to say to my classmates, but I used to just, you know, whisper to them anyway. Just go to their ear. It's like, what? You ever did that to somebody's ear? Just the fact that somebody wants to listen to you. They're willing to listen to nothing. And even when we're grown-ups, don't we whisper to each other? You know, we can't say something out loud, so we whisper it. Oh, here she comes. Oh, here she comes. Here comes trouble. And sometimes you hear that. What? What? Your fly is open. But we like to hear each other's voices, especially when we know the person. How would it be if somebody just came up to you and told you a secret you don't know? How would that feel? You're like, the milk is bad. Milk is bad for you. You're like, this guy I don't even know. Person I don't even know. They come into me. They whisper a secret that the milk is bad. I don't know. What do you think? This person is crazy. But if somebody you know came up to you and whispered to you, the milk is bad. Man, milk is really bad for you. Wouldn't it be, oh, yes, 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 I know. Thank you. It's different when you know somebody who's speaking to you. And so Midian, at this point in time, when he heard those soldiers speaking, he knew it was the voice of God. How did he know it was the voice of God? He spent time with God. Didn't he spend time before? With the fleece, you know, with the ground being wet, with the soldiers. Get in, you have too many soldiers. What? I started out with 32, now I have 22 or 32. I forgot the numbers, but it was around there. And then it went all the way down to how many? How many men did he end up? You remember when they crossed that river and the ones that went on their knees? No, don't take those. Take the ones that take the water by the hand in. There were 300. And you say to yourself, 300? You know, in biblical times, 300 is just a little family get-together. You know, you hear numbers, 100,000, 150,000. You know, all these numbers. And they were array, and I just cannot imagine, you know? But God spoke to Gideon before, and Gideon had a relationship with God. And so every day, Gideon spoke to God until one voice came one day and said, though man of valor. Oh, God, why is this happening to us? See, Gideon knew. Even before he was on the threshing floor with those grapes. I'm sorry, with the wheat and the grape. He knew the word of God. He was talking to God. And God was speaking to him in a still voice. But now, God came to him, spoke to him, and he heard. And by the time he came to this point where the soldiers were speaking, he knew that it was God. So how can we get to know the voice of God? We have to start young as possible, reading the Word of God, right? Spending time with God in prayer. How else are you going to know? When God speaks to you, you say, that's the Heavenly Father. But you have to know the will of God in order to recognize His voice, don't you? So is it important to hear voices? Not voices, you know, like in voices, but hear your parents' voices and listen. That's important. How important it is to recognize the voice of God and to listen to Him. It's even more important. But we cannot do it unless we're into the Bible and we know the will of God. So when He speaks to us, we don't say, oh, what a stranger. No, we say, oh, Lord, that's You. And so Gideon had the victory because he obeyed the voice of God. And so you, young as you are, you can have the victory also. Jesus. At this time, we're going to have a collection, a tithes and offering. Psalms 24, verse 1 says, "The Lord, the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein." So everything belongs to God, but He requires us a tenth of all. And so at this time, Brother Ernesto will collect a tithes and offering. Heavenly Father, we thank you, dear Lord, for all the marvelous gifts that you give to us. Many wonderful blessings at this time, so many that we can just spend the rest of the day in that goodness and talking about the things that are wonderful that you give to us. But we thank you, dear Heavenly Father, most of all, for allowing us to study the greatest gift, Jesus Christ, that you have given to us. And we thank you, dear Lord, for partaking in this economy, giving a tenth back with offerings, dear Lord, to help and support those who minister in the ministry. We ask, dear Lord, that you bless the tithes and offerings. And we know, dear Heavenly Father, with little you could do much. But, dear Heavenly Father, most of all, let us not take for granted the gifts that you have given to us and what it took to receive salvation. So we thank you again, dear Heavenly Father, for thy wonderful gifts of life. And we thank you for your word. And we thank you for the family. Many thanks, dear Lord. We ask that we may glorify thee with all the things that we have. In Christ I pray. Amen. And they shall put my name upon the children of Israel, and I will bless them. And this is the Lord's name on our souls and our hearts, and we will be blessed. At this time, we're going to pray. If there's any prayers or requests at this time, I will take them, being that we're so few. We're not that few. It's a good group here. We pray, of course, for those that are online. I know there are people online, right? So we want to pray for them, and we're thankful that they're viewing. Yes. Okay. Okay. All those things could be overcome. But it takes work. It's, you know, prayer and I've heard amazing stories of people overcoming serious situations. And so we have faith that they can overcome too. And anybody else have prayer requests?
My immediate and extended family.
Family. Okay. Missing members. Missing members. Okay. Okay. And also, as we come to the close of this quarter, communion is next week. We have communion next week, so let us prepare for communion this week coming up. So, yes.
Job decision.
Okay.
Job decision and also for unspoken.
Okay. Very important for us to choose wisely, right? And seek on the counsel of God. This all the prayer requests. At this time, we're going to kneel, sing hymn number 671, and then we'll pray.
Now, dear Lord, as we pray, take our hearts and minds far away from the press of the world all around, to your throne where grace does abound. May our lives be transformed by your love. May our souls be refreshed from above. At this moment, let people everywhere join us now as we come to you in prayer.
O dear Heavenly Father, hallowed be thy name. Dear Lord, we thank you again over and over for us being here. And although we're not perfect, we're thankful for the light that we do have. And the light that we have to use wisely, or else we do not receive new light. But the light that we do have, not only that we have to act upon it, but we also have to share it, or else the light will go out. But we thank you for allowing us not to go through this dark world unsure of where we came from and where we're going. Dear Heavenly Father, we know where we came from, and we know where we're going if we're faithful. Dear Heavenly Father, many people struggle for what's in between, the different hurdles, the different obstacles that have to be overcome in life in order for us to achieve this wonderful character that you have. Dear Heavenly Father, we know that this is possible. You have demonstrated to us in your ministry here on this earth, and now that you're in the most holy place in heaven, we know that, dear Heavenly Father, our prayers are being not only heard, but also answered according to thy will. So we have faith, dear Lord, that we're able to reach a character of perfection. And we need to do this in order for us to enter to heaven. And this will take a lot of work and effort and letting go of the world. Dear Heavenly Father, I ask that if there's anybody here who's struggling with anything, whatever it is, that they seek thee with all their hearts and know that you will carry them through, that they can overcome sin, that we can grab onto that yoke and put it on and be able to go through this life, not only with the faith that we're going to have eternal blessings, but have temporary blessings here on earth. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, dear Lord, for those that are viewing online. We know, dear Heavenly Father, these people are looking and searching for you. And so we ask, dear Lord, that what's said today may be gratifying to their hearts, knowing that you are speaking to them. Dear Heavenly Father, we know that there are many people that are hungry and searching for truth. And we thank you for a means in which we can reach others around the country and around the world. Dear Lord, we pray also for the petition of Brother Nesto, for Ricardo and his aunt, Sister Ramona. We know, dear Heavenly Father, that these two individuals are experiences difficulties in different ways. But nonetheless, we all have difficulties. And we know that there is only one answer, which is you. Christ Jesus. And so we pray, dear Lord, that they seek thee with all their hearts and to give themselves time to get to know you and to know that you are taking care of them. Sometimes we want problems to be resolved in a moment or in a second's notice. But sometimes these problems linger. And this is for us to learn the lesson to depend upon you. Dear Heavenly Father, we also pray for our families, especially for Alumsai, who has a petition to pray for her family in an inner circle, an immediate and extended family. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, that they seek thee with their hearts and that not only can we reconcile with each other, but we reconcile with our family as well. You want us to be here, faithful, and get along here on earth. For if we're going to spend eternity together, don't we have to get along? So we ask thee, Lord, that our hearts and minds be softened to your word. Dear Lord, we pray for missing members at this time. We pray that they're being fed wherever they are, and we miss them very much, and we hope to have them soon. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray for Tito, who has a petition of a decision that he needs to make. We know, dear Heavenly Father, that decisions are very important, especially when it comes to financial income. And so we pray, dear Lord, that he seeks thee with all his heart to make the proper decision. And we know, dear Heavenly Father, that making a living at any time and age in this world is not easy. But dear Heavenly Father, if we seek thee with all our hearts, you will supply our needs, including the decision as to where we should work. Dear Heavenly Father, we're thankful so much at this time. We're going to hear the bread of life. We thank you for Pastor Lloyd Grubb, who's going to do this at this time. We ask you, Lord, that our hearts and minds be put away all things of the world at this time and think of heavenly things, dear Lord. And we thank you for giving us this space in order for us to hear your word loud and clear and peace and joy in our hearts. I ask all of these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and we thank you again for the great blessings that you're giving us today. In Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen.
Hear our prayers, O Lord. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Incline thine ear to us and grant us thy peace. Amen.
Let us turn to the book of Exodus. Let's go to the book of Exodus, and we're going to turn to chapter 22. In the book of Exodus, chapter 22, we're going to read verses 21 through 24. Okay, so this is the time of affliction. It says here, ye shall not afflict any widow or fatherless child. If thou afflict them in any wise, and they cry at all unto me, I will surely hear their cry, and my wrath shall wax hot. And I will kill you with the sword, and your wives shall be widows, and your children fatherless.
Let's give 1 second here as I set the PowerPoint up. Thanks, Tamar. So I'm good, Daniel, right? Thanks. That's good. All right. So welcome again to Covenant Advent Church. Thanks for visiting us, Brother Pierre. It's been a blessing to meet you. And this afternoon, our topic is what are the current crises we face. So hopefully I'm pronouncing that right. Crises we face, plural of crisis. Right, so this is what we're looking at. We have quite a few verses we're going to go through, and we're starting a little bit late, so you're going to give me a little extra time. Won't delay your meal eating for too long. So crises we're facing. Tamar, if you could just grab that clicker for me, if you don't mind. It's in the front part of my bag. What are the crises we face? And just want to say that this is a two-part. I'm doing part one this morning, and I'm kind of going to go through a quick overview. And then in the evening at 5:30 for the Bible study, I'll finish part two. And then in the October, I'll continue what my the Bible class that we were doing on the King of the North. We'll pick back up the King of the North in the beginning of October, because next week I'm gonna have something else on schedule that I'm gonna do. I'm gonna do a health seminar in the evening at 5:30 next week on root herb. You know, herbs like golden seal and stuff like that. So that's what I'll be doing Saturday evening, 5:30. So I won't be able to pick up the Bible class again until in October. So anyhow, so our topic again is, what are the current crises we face? And let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, we thank thee again for the blessings of your word. And we ask, dear Lord, a special unction from thy spirit for myself and also for all those who are here listening and watching online. May you bless us by thy grace, we pray, for Christ's sake. Amen. So what are the current crises we face? Now, on this board here, on this list here, are some of the things that we face. Number one crisis that we face is salvation. We have lost our way because of sin. And I put that first because I want you to just to think about that as the first thing that we face, the overall thing. That's our main problem as human beings. But there's all the other problems that we have to deal with. And right there, I list all the other problems that we deal with from day to day and our societies deal with. And you might have some other ones that are not listed here that you could come up with. And there's some more that I could come up with. But these are the main ones, I think, that affect us as a society right now in America, around the world. So I'm going to give you some little time to kind of peruse that, to think about that. I'm going to read it real quickly. And then when you think about it, what are the current crises? Now, every crisis that we deal with, the Bible has remedy for the crises. And so salvation, the fatherless, I put that as number two. And then after that, there's no list. I just put these two at the top. Temporal prosperity decline, hopelessness, and you add to that suicide, fatalistic thinking, mental problem, depression, demon possession, unstable marriages, environmental problems, oppression of the poor, which include poverty and injustice, lifestyle disease and pain and communicable diseases, religious intolerance, which we'll call religious liberty, is another way to trigger our thoughts, drug and alcohol addiction, substance abuse, and also overeating, ignorance. Both types of ignorance, whether it be ignorance of just natural information like math, English, and ignorance of the Bible. False doctrine, spiritualism, these are some of the problems that we face because of ignorance. Violence, unkindness, people ripping you off, war, people conning you out of your money. Covetousness, greed, love of money, feeling inadequate, sexual abuse, sexual crimes, and the care for the ages. These are crises that we currently face. As America moves towards the baby boomers getting older, we're going to create a crisis in the sense of there's going to be a massive need for nursing homes. There's going to be a massive need for, you know, assisted living, and then for funeral homes, because more people will be dying off in the next decade or so. These are crises that we face, major crises. Now, as a church, first question I'd like to ask you is, you review the list that is in front of you and think, what is the greatest crisis being faced by our society or the world today? You look at that list. In your mind, if you wanted to come to a point, what is the greatest crisis that the world face, right, today? What is right now? If I ask you as a church, what is supposed to be your focus, number one focus, right? And then you list them. You pick this list and you start to pick off stuff and you add stuff that I don't have on the list. What is your focus? What should be the church focus? Because we have a problem in society.
and we are supposed to focus on the crisis. When we think about what present truth is to meet the current problem that the society face. What is your focus? What is the biggest problem you're facing? And then what is the bigger problem the general society is facing? What should be our focus? Because that's what we're here for. That's our primary mode of mission. So you think about that as you look at that list. Now think, what is the focus of the church and ministries? What is the focus of the churches and ministries? Not church as a big conglomerate, but individual churches. You go to a local church, you say, what is this church focus about? Focus on. What is their focus? Then you think about ministries. There's many major ministries within Adventism and many major ministries outside of Adventism in other denominations. What are their focus? What is it that they focus on? And then think about what they're focused on, and then think about what is going on in the society. What's killing the society right now? What's causing untold death and destruction in the society? The next question I want you to think about with me is, what is the focus of, what is the issues, is their focus? So what issues? So you listen to a ministry all the time. You watch them on television. You read their magazine. And you can sense, what is their focus? What is their what do they think on this list here? What do they think on this list here is their major focus? That means their pinpoint, every time they put out a publication, every time they put out a video, every time they put out of whatever, what are they focused on? Now, will you think with me? And you're thinking about it, right? Hopefully. Now, think with me, do their ministry line up with a natural reading of the Bible and its wide focus or solution it brings? Do their ministry line up with a natural reading? So when you read the Bible naturally, so you just pick the Bible and you start reading it. What is the focus of the Bible? Especially the solutions that the Bible brings. And does their ministry focus on the wide focus of the Bible? The Bible is not very narrow. It's very wide. The way is narrow, but it's focused because it focuses on all the problems that sin brings. So when you think with me now, think about the average ministry out there. And they have a burden to bear. They have a gospel to bring to the world. What is their focus? What are they bringing? So first we're going to do, and when you think about that now, and before I go to my first point, now look at me now back over this list again. Salvation. So we say all ministries are focused on salvation of people. Every church, that's what we say. We just give them a check mark. We're not going to question them on that. We're going to say they are focused. And many people say, Lord, they're not. But they are. Ministries, churches. The fatherless. Confused, violent, outcast, abused. This is what's going on with the fatherless. Now you think about this. You almost never hear any talk about the fatherless. No focus. You think about what's going on in the inner city, the violence, the killing. Think about places like Chicago, where this year they're already up. They already broken last year record. They're on a record pace year. And who's that primarily dying? Not the fatherless female. Most of the fatherless female, they're going to turn prostitutes. The fatherless male, drug dealers, gangbangers. You hear a voice out of the pulpits across America. You're voicing Adventism. You're voicing this ministry. This is a crisis. I mean, to me, a lot of these other crises come because of this one crisis right here. A lot of these other things is because of this. Not a focus. I can guarantee you could go across the land in America and go from church to church and you can only find an elder that is a father. That will father the young men in the church and in the community and say, I'm going to teach you something. I can tell you my testimony is that I never experienced that. And I learned in my life, I said, I have to become that for the young men. What is the, I mean, this to me is one of the most disturbing things. You know, there's so many young women going sea and land trying to find a young man, especially in the church. There's a problem in the church for young men. No young men. And yet we don't focus on this problem here, the fatherless. How to stop all of this that's going on. But yet we say we have a crisis. I'm going to tell you what the focus of most ministry and the church is this right here. Religious intolerance. Is this a crisis in America right now? Imagine we spend billions of dollars. We do about a $2 billion budget every year. And we spend most of our focus right here. And all of this, we ignore for the most part. Religious intolerance. We talk about the Pope until we're blue in the face. Millions of dollars just focus. If the Pope sneezes, if he trips, we spend printed page after printed page, and this is all we talk about. And the other thing we talk about is the government. If the government does something, we focus all our energies there. But we couldn't care less what's going on. They're massacring each other in the inner city. We have churches in the inner city. And what are the churches in the inner city doing? The people there are this. This is what happened. Ignorantism. No teaching. We have a dropout rate, especially in the inner city, that blows the mind. Most of these kids are going to end up on the side of the street. And yet, guess what happened? If you talk about this, you bore people. Talk about this, you put them to sleep. But this is what they're excited about. I'm going to deal with this in a few minutes. Now, temporal prosperity is declining. Where's our focus? Hopelessness, suicide, whatever. We have people in the church killing themselves, even evangelists killing themselves. Yet we act as if it doesn't happen. We have some of the most depressed people in our churches. It doesn't happen. We don't talk about it. Demon possession, happening. I remember somebody said, look, Lloyd, I really used to just enjoy going to Africa doing evangelism. I said, no, I can't go to the person anymore. It's just like even the pastors and their wives now have demon possession. It's a rampant problem over there. Unstable marriages. You can't even get a good marriage counseling. Environmental problems in our society. No talk. Oppression of the poor, poverty and justice. Zero. No talk about this. In the church, not from the pulpits. They don't talk about it. Lifestyle disease. We talk about communicable disease because this is the focus of the hospital system. So I say one, a little bit of this probably because we just drug them up. Communicable diseases, we try to stop the disease that you can catch, like the viruses. And then this one right here, we focus. Lifestyle disease, we have given up this work. When we talk about medical missionary work, it's not hard to know the hospital, it has to do with lifestyle disease. Some of it has to do with this. Drugs and alcohol addiction. I've heard some noise now from some institution over there in California. They're trying to see if they can do some work to face this problem. 20% of all Americans dying are dying because of this problem. And this is a crisis. Yet, we don't talk about it. You hardly can even hear sermons about alcohol and drugs. No, people don't talk about this stuff. Yet, we have in whole areas, we have in church members dying of this stuff, pastors getting hooked on drugs and everything, and nobody talks. It's like, it does not happen. I'm like, the crisis is going on around us, heroin addiction, rampant. The society don't know what to do. And we have the message to deal with this issue. And we quiet while our own kids are going off to become drug addicts. Overeating, 30-something percent of America now is obese and morbidly obese. We don't talk. Ignorance, bow tie, false doctrine. We're closing schools instead of opening schools. And a time when ignorance is so rampant in our society and in the church, we're closing schools. We have so many inner city churches now. All they're there for is to worship, to sing song, and to hear the pastor give a grace-orientated sermon, and that's it. Violence, unkindness, rip-off, con, all that stuff going on. People are rampant for this. Most people, they think they're doing church, they're just being ripped off. And then covetousness, greed, love of money, feeling inadequate. Many people live like the drones because they're inadequate. They feel like they need to make it. Sexual abuse, sexual crime, massive problem. And then crimes, care for the aged, is a massive problem already. We can't even house our old people. Most of the old people can't survive because they can't pay the taxes. So that's the list. So I would say when you look at what the main focus, as I say, how many ministries out there, all they talk about is conspiracy theory, or if the Pope, as I say, if he breathes, they talk about it. Waste of time or waste of pages. Now, are we supposed to talk about that? Yes. So I'm going to go into the Bible. I'm going to show you now what I mean when I say the natural reading of the Bible and how ministries don't line up and churches don't line up with the natural reading of the Bible and the problems, the natural problems that are going on in society and how, I don't know, where this false would come to us, where we so focus on what the Pope does that we become fanatics. And the people are dying. People are dying right at our feet, as Ernest did well. And thank you for closing that off because you did what you needed to do. You introduced my sermon. The people are hungry right in front of us, drugs, everything. And we say what we need to focus on, the Pope is about to cause a national civil war. Because we have false interpretation. They've made us become silly. Now, what happened in Matthew chapter 11, verse 13 through 16. I'm going to go through some of this information fast, and then in the evening, I'm going to go into it in a slower form. I want to show you the natural reading of the Bible and how they've created, made the church become impotent by making the church have a false reading of the Bible. Matthew chapter 11, verse 3 through 6 says, so Christ's view of his ministry. Look how Christ views ministry. And he said unto him, art thou he that should come? Or do we look for another? Jesus answered and said unto them, Go and show John again those things which ye do hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, the leper are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Notice here, Christ was dealing with the emergencies of his time. Christ did more healing than he did what? Preaching, because what was the emergency at the time? Well, the sickness. If you read the Bible from Matthew to Malachi, you rarely hear the Bible talks about sickness, because the diseases were not upon the land, because the human body was much stronger. But over the centuries after Malachi, when Christ came on the scene, you had a problem with demon possession and a lot of diseases that are what we would call communicable diseases, leper, weaknesses in the system, blindness. You don't hear the Bible talk hardly about lifestyle disease, because that was not the emergency at that time. You think again about Paul. Paul probably was one of the only person that even referred to a lifestyle disease for the most part. He says that's a drink wine because it's good for the what? The stomach, right? But throughout the Bible, you don't hear much about lifestyle disease. What you hear about is communicable diseases. It is a disease that you can catch. Today in our world, you still have those diseases, but added to those diseases, what we have is lifestyle disease, because the bodies of human beings have been riddled because of sin. So you focus on the emergency that's there. Christ focused on the emergency that he dealt with in his time. Natural reading of the Bible, natural ministry. Sickness, Christ focused more on sickness than he focused even on preaching doctrines. But he did preach doctrines also. Naturally in the Bible. So here comes a ministry. They say, oh, we're going to finish the work. How are you going to finish the work? Oh, we're going to preach. What are we going to preach about? Oh, we're going to talk only about the Pope. But the people are dying around you. Why don't you talk about that? Why don't you build natural health ministries? Oh, no, we're closing those. We have to focus on the work. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 16. Isaiah 1, verse 16. Now, notice the prophet Isaiah and Isaiah's concern as it relates to God's displeasure on the people. Notice the natural reading of the Bible. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 16, and we're going to go all the way down to verse 24. Listen to the natural reading of the Bible. This is how the prophets ministered and what their focus was. And think about what the focus of the major ministries across our land and the millions and millions of dollars they waste. And they don't touch the problem of society. They don't even talk about it. They don't talk about it at all. It boggles the mind. Look at it. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 16. It says, wash you and make you clean. Who does the washing? Jesus. I'm going to read the Bible again. Wash you and make you clean. Who does the washing? You wash yourself. What's the focus of the ministries today? God's going to wash you. But what's the focus of the Bible? You wash yourself. Here's the soap. Here's the water. What you should do? Go wash yourself. God's not going to come and wash you. You need to wash yourself. Notice again. Put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. Who is going to put away the evil? Amen, church. Church. Amen. Amen. You're going to put away the evil of your doing? Yes. Okay, who's going to cease to do evil? Me. You're going to. You could read the Bible and you could say, oh no, God's going to give you the... God says, look, you do it. You stop. Somebody's going to stop and you're going to stop. Notice it continues, verse 17. Learn to do well, seek judgment, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, the who? The fatherless, and plead for the who? The widow. That's the natural reading of the Bible. Notice the Bible, it doesn't even do charity the way we do charity. The focal point of charity is fatherless and widow. If a person is a young man or a young woman and she can't work and he can't work, the Bible said no money to them. No support. Go work. But those who are fatherless and their widow, they're the one that gets the support. That's the natural reading of the Bible. We have wasted a lot of times with all these type of evil, big stuff that we do for care of people and poor people that we ain't supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be focused on those who can't help themselves. Those who can't help themselves, they need to go on. But notice here, seek judgment. So when we talk about the church as being quiet when and we should have been the forefront of the innocent projects. All these men, especially black men that have been locked up in prison because of racism, we should have been there to try to help them out of prison. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Who is being oppressed? What have they been oppressed by my country? I need to work for them. Not quiet. But that's the natural reading of the Bible. Notice again here, plead the cause of the widow. Is the widow getting herself into problems because of the society? Yeah, we're supposed to be there. So when I talk about care for the aged, this is why I put that there. Who's going to take care of the aged? These women, that mostly women. Today, nothing have changed. Even though we have gone more in, what you call it, in medical advancements, most of the old people are women. Who are supposed to be taking care of them? Who are supposed to set up nursing homes? But somebody would say, I spend $1 million to send great controversies to Philadelphia. But I refuse to send $1 million to send some missionaries and send some people to help the poor people in Philadelphia. Because they're black most of the time. But I'd send $1 million worth of great controversy in Philadelphia. But I refuse to do anything to help the poor people there. Because I don't care. Because my focal point is to tell people about the Pope. And the poor people are dying and suffering, and I refuse to give a word or spend a dollar to help the need of the poor people. This is where we're going to finish the gospel. And when we preach, Jesus is going to come because we told him about the Pope. And the people have hungry bellies and they can't eat. They've been oppressed by the massive system that we have here in America that oppress poor people and create all these ghettos across America. And all these young men are gangbangers. Why? Because we created a failed schooling system. And we created this welfare system that kept their mothers and their fathers separated. And all these things that we did to destroy the communities. And what do we do? What do we do as a church? We say, oh, our focal point is to tell people Jesus is coming soon. And Jesus still ain't coming because we have gone away from the natural reading of the Bible and from the natural work that we're supposed to do. We continue reading verse 18. Come now, let us what? Reason. Because we are unreasonable. We're dumb. And the Bible says, come now, let us what? Reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be as what?
Scarlet.
Scarlet, red. They shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. People say, oh, that's a good altar call text. But notice what was said before and what's going to say after. Why do people's sins are so terrible? Because people say, I'm good. I'm a good Christian. No, you're not. You know, you don't line up with the Bible. Look what happened next. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat of the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured by the what?
Sword.
Physical sword. Not a spiritual sword here. For the mouth of the Lord, I'd spoken it. There's many churches right now weeping and mourning. Tennessee, West Virginia, all these places. Drug is wiping them out. Physically dying. Many people have to bury their kids. Many Adventists burying their kids. Baptists, Methodists burying their kids. And they're burying some of themselves. They're being devoured by the sword because they refuse to do the right thing. And notice the areas that he's wiping out, these areas where they're part of the oppression of the system. God's not sleeping. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land, but if not, you'll be eaten by, devoured by the sword. How is the faithful city become a harlot? That's the question. How has it become a what? How does that happen? You ever ask yourself the question, how does a person become a harlot? Blows the mind. But there's a logical process. It was full of judgment. You could go there and the widow would go to the judge and they're going to get the right. The fatherless was going to get taken care of. But that stopped. So he's saying, how did this happen? Righteousness lodged in it. But now what?
Murderers.
Now these are spiritual murderers. They're physical murderers. Remember, Nebuchadnezzar was sent to Israel to destroy it because of what? The wickedness that was going on in it. God had to put an end to it. The evil was so much that God says, I'm going to have to stop this madness. They had become evil instead of they were the righteous people of God. Verse 22 says, thy silver has become what? Dross. And thy wine mixed with water. They're watered down. Thy princes are rebellious. This is what happened to church leadership. And companions of what? Thieves. How many times you hear about pastors ahead in the system in various different churches caught up in Ponzi scheme? Who are the members? Who are the people that invested in the Ponzi scheme? The members. They took the members' money, invested it, and eat the money. And the members lost the money, and after they lost the money, then they become Governor General of Jamaica. So, thy prince are rebellious and companions of thieves. Remember in Christ's time, was this true? What did Christ do in order for him to preach in the temple? He ran out the money changers. Who the money changers were in cahoots with? Who were the money changers currently? With the priests. The money changers are in cahoots with the priests. Instead of the, think about it, instead of the money go in to open up health food stores, instead of the money goes in to open up sanitariums to give natural remedies and natural treatment, where did the money go to on Wall Street? You didn't hear me. Where is the money going? Take all the time. Remember, tithe is there for one purpose. The tithe is there to use for the gospel work. You collect the tithes of the people, you hoard it together, and you take it, you put it on Wall Street. Wait a minute, but why don't you put it back into where the money came from in the first place? Why don't you invest in things that the Lord told us to invest in? If you have $2 billion, and you know you were supposed to set up health food stores all across the land, why didn't you do it? Why do you allow Whole Foods to do it instead? Hmm? Whole Foods now is a multi-billion, billion dollar corporation. Why didn't you do it? But you took the money and invested in Wall Street so it can go into McDonald's and Burger King and all these places. You wasted the money because the goal has become what? Literally, drugs. But somebody said, oh, there's millions of dollars on Wall Street. Yeah, but you could have invested in what the Lord told you to invest it in. You shortchange, do no investment, and you took the money and put it to build big corporations of America. While, where are the buildings that supposed to house these widows? Where are they? Where are the orphanage? How many orphanage we have all across America in Adventism? How many? We were told to build them, but you have money where? You have money in stock market. And somebody say, oh, well, we did well. It's notice that the wine has become watered down. It's not that it's not wine. It's just watered down. The silver has become dross. There's some silver there, but it's all cankered and it's wasted. And you say, oh, look at this, it's so great, but it could have been greater. We missed the opportunity, but somebody's going to take the opportunity, and that's why we're here. Now, look at it there. It says here that, and everyone loveth gifts, verse 23. And follow it after what? Reward. So they like money on the table. They judge not the who? Fatherless. Focus of the Bible. Look at the focus of the Bible. Fatherless. The folk of, look, remember, one of the worst sin that the Catholic Church did was abuse those little boys. Worst sin of the Catholic Church. Worst. Who are supposed to take care of those little boys? We're supposed to be one. Let them do what they're going to do, but we're supposed to be one said, we're going to put money and we're going to open up those orphanages. Because there's still fatherless kids that need to be taken care of. And we're not going to allow them to go over there and get the priest to rape them. But instead what we do, we say we're not going to do it. Because we're rebellious, because we like reward. Neither doth the cause of the widow come unto them. Therefore, says the Lord of hosts, the mighty one of Israel, I will ease myself of my adversaries and avenge me of my enemies. Who are the enemies? Who are the enemies? Remember, the secular people are always going to be secular people. The question is, what is our opportunity and what were we supposed to do in the earth? We were supposed to be the salt. We were supposed to be one to help that every time the Catholic Church did something evil or the Baptist and Methodist Church did something evil, we were supposed to be one to cushion that. Let them cause war, we go over there and feed the people and they displace them. We were supposed to want to do that. We know that's their aim, to kill and destroy. We were supposed to, but we drop the ball. And we don't do it. And if somebody rise up in the system and say, hey, we need to do something, they shut you down and call you crazy. So we move on. Micah chapter 10, verse 5 through 16. I'm going through this because I want to see the natural reading of the Bible. And when you think about that, we have a craziness that's come up amongst us where we think that says the only thing that we're supposed to do is focus on just start saying about religious intolerance. That's the only thing we talk about, religious intolerance. That's it. And we might do some communicable disease through a hospital. We might do some big ADRA, airlift. I don't know what else we do. And we leave everything as the world going to hell in a basket. We have churches now in these cities. I've been to these churches. In the middle of the bombed out area, you have a beautiful, nice church. And you go to the church and say, what are they? I know what they're going to talk about. They're going to talk about how to help the poor. You go to the church and all they talk about is worship Jesus. let's get into worship. You're like, what? Don't they see what's around them? Are they not concerned? Nope. They're just here to worship on Sabbath. And forget about the Sunday churches. They're a mess. Amos chapter 10, verse 5 through 16 says, these 12 Jesus sent forth. And now we're looking at Christ's ministry as our template. And notice the focus and method of Christ's ministry. Jesus sent forth 12 and command them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles and into the city of the Samaritans either entering. So in our natural today form, that would be if we're going to do ministry, Christ said, don't go to the secular folks first. And definitely don't go to the Sunday church folk. Just go to Adventists. This is basically like an idea. When Christ and his disciples, he didn't send them to the Gentiles and he didn't send them to the Samaritans first. Ultimately, he was going to send them to the Samaritan next. And after the Samaritans, he will send them to the Gentiles after. But first, go to those who are of the house first and start there. Now, what's going on in the house? We're going to read. But rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This is supposed to be our message. Christ is about to come. So that means the people are not even aware of it, even though Christ is about to come. What does he say to do? Heal the sick. So were there sick people in Israel? Cleanse the leper. Were there lepers in Israel? Raise the dead, that means that people are dying. Cast out devils, where the demon possessed people in Israel. Right, so he said, go there and get the devils out of these people. All right, freely you have received, freely you have give. What is he saying? You've got the devil out of you, I got the devil out of you, now get it out of somebody. Amen? Amen. Provide neither gold, nor silver, nor brass for your purse, nor scrip for your journey. Neither two coats, nor neither shoes, nor yet staff. For the workman is worthy of his what? Is meat or higher. That means when you work in the gospel, you're supposed to get paid. But your method of labor in verse 8 is freely. You freely give, but you shouldn't go hungry. Does that make sense? Notice, Christ had to do this because was the disciples of Christ going to be paid by the mainline system? No. That makes sense? They weren't going to be paid by the mainline system, so how were they going to eat? Those who you go and minister to, they should give you payment. All right? And whatsoever city you go, you shall enter in. Inquire who is worthy, and there abide till ye go thence. Now, is the disciples are going amongst Jews, is everybody worthy that they're going amongst? No, that tells you. In Israel, you're going to preach in Israel to Jews, and they're not worthy. It would be the same thing today. If you're going amongst Adventism, you have to go and ask, you go to the local church, you say, hey, look, who is worthy in this church for me to go minister to? Because most people in the church are not worthy. That's the reality. And when you come into a house, salute it. And if the house be worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if he not be worthy, let your peace return. Method of labor. And whosoever shall not receive you, nor hear your word, when ye depart out of that house or city, shake off the dust of your feet. Verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable in the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than in that city. Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of what? Wolves. Who are the wolves? And where is he sending them? Amongst Jews? It would be like going amongst Adventists. He said, go amongst Adventists and find who is worthy. And I'm sending you as sheep among who? The Adventists themselves are wolves. I want you to learn. Because if you think they're wolves and they're bad, imagine going to the Samaritans. Are they going to be worse? Imagine going to the secular people. Are they going to be worse? So I first want you to learn how to deal with wolves amongst the Jews. Natural reading of the Bible. Is that natural? Is that true today?
Yes.
Is that true today? Exodus chapter 22, our scripture reading. I want to quickly go through a few more of these. So we notice Christ's ministry and he set up his ministry and he set up his disciples to do work. Natural, the focus. Notice I'm just drawing some essence there from the focus of what Christ is dealing with. He's dealing with stuff that's going on. He's not one track. One track. Every day. How are we going to talk about it? The Pope sneezes, how are we going to talk about it? Christ is dealing with the real suffering of humanity around him in the church and later on outside of the church. Our ministry has to focus that way as we're wasting time. We can't see, we can't go into a town and we're in a city and we're looking and we're like, wow, there's all these ignorant people. There's all these people on drugs, alcohol, violence, all these things. And we say, our message today to you is that the Pope is going to call a national Sunday law. You're dumb. That's what it is. You're just foolish. And you're following idiots. There's no other way for me to say it. Look around you. The people are suffering from all kinds of things. They say, I'm not going to put a dollar into a drug rehab. 20% of Americans are going to die this year of drugs, overdose. I'm not going to put a dollar into that. I don't care. All I want to tell them is that the emergency right now is that they're going to be a national son in law. That you mentally ill. To think that this is what you're telling me. Oh, I'm going to spend $1 million. And if you go to them and say, could we spend $500,000? Could we spend $250,000? Forget about that. Could we spend $80,000? Forget about that. Could we spend $40,000 to just open up a little hole in the wall restaurant? No. Can't do it. I must spend $1 million to get great controversy to them because I need to tell them that the pub is about to cause national cinema. But these people are obese. Sorry. Obese. They're dying from high blood pressure and all kind of things. And many of them are members of our church. And I refuse to spend a dollar to help them. And I refuse to support anybody that's going to help them because anybody that's going to preach the help message, they're fanatics. Because all we need to do is give them drugs in their system. We're crazy. And people follow these people and give them millions of dollars as donations. And you can't get nobody to wake up and say, look at the sufferings around me here. Natural reading, Exodus 22, verse 21. Just notice, I'm just speaking some text to show the natural flow and interest of the Bible, focus of the Bible. And that is not like what we are talking about as doing ministry. But yet we say we're going to finish the work. And I'm thinking, what work? You don't see the work. Exodus 22, verse 21 onward says, thou shalt not vex a stranger, nor oppress him. For you were strangers in the land of Egypt. That's the natural reading of the Bible. Is that the natural focus of the Bible? Yet we have so many Adventists that are anti-immigration, anti-immigrants, hate immigrants, and call themselves Christians. They're not concerned with all the NAFTA and all the free trade agreements that we did in South America and Central America. That's causing so many people to suffer and can't have a job and can't eat. And they want to come across the border to come into America and get a job. They're not concerned with that. Change your policies. Free up and give some more money to the poor people. It's nice to be able to go into Walmart and buy cheap stuff being produced by South American and Central Americans. But guess what happened? Pay them 10 cents more per hour. Pay them 50 cents more per hour and start letting them come to America. But yeah, we don't do that. We don't call for changes because we don't care. So verse 22 says, ye shall not afflict any widow. Natural focus of the Bible again. Or fatherless. Natural focus of the Bible. You tell me that you're doing ministry and your focal point is not this. What's your ministry? You ain't going nowhere. You're sucking up money and you're going to pay your bills. But you're not helping. The widow and the fatherless is always the focus of the Bible. Amen. Those who are less fortunate, the stranger, always the focus of the Bible. Was Christ in a similar situation?
Yeah.
Christ is on the cross. He's dying. And what was his number one focus? His mother. She's a widow. And she lost the oldest son. It's his responsibility to take care of her, and he's dying. You could say, I'm God, I'm going to take care of it. I'm going to heaven, I'm going to take care of it. But he says, no, let's stop for a second. Don't die yet. Let's stop. John, could you take care of her? And that's it. He didn't make one of his brother take care of her. It was one of his brother, one of his sister. He's going to say, look, I know who will take care of my mom best. John, your responsibility. And he's okay, no, I can't die. Natural reading of the Bible. Natural focus. How we say we so great ministry? Are we doing such great ministry? Burning millions of dollars doing television programs. Shut those cameras off. Sell them off on eBay. And go give it to the poor and the fatherless.
Amen.
Foolishness. Have people suffering all around you and your focus is just living large. Showing that so we can buy a $100,000 camera. Great. Great. For what? Notice verse 23. If thou afflict them in any wise, and they cried all unto me, I will surely hear their cry. This is happening. This text is being fulfilled today. And my wrath shall wax hot, and I will kill you with the sword. And your wives will be what?
Widows.
And your children what?
Fatherless.
I remember this old lady, it was a pastor's wife in Adventism. She says, you know, I never focus on these texts. Until my husband died. And I became a widow. And all of a sudden I saw that all these years I never really helped none of these people. And I became one. And now I understand. My support is cut off. And now I understand why the Bible is so focused on that. Because I can't myself. You can't go back to work when you're 70. The body just not going to allow it. Somebody going to have to help you. And if the church sit back and say, our million should be spent in doing this, you're joking. It's after you have done this work that you should focus on the other work. And this is what our feeling has been natural reading of the Bible. Notice verse 25. If thou lend to any of my people that is poor by thee. Not people have money now. People are poor. Thou shalt not be to him as an usury, neither shalt thou lay upon him usury. Notice the focal point is the who? The poor. Not talking about somebody who can pay back. Talk about somebody who cannot pay back. Christ dealt with that in Matthew chapter 5, 6. He says, literally, chapter 5, he says, and 6, he says, if you somebody asks, you give. He's not talking about those who have money. You know? Those who don't. If thou at all take thy neighbor raiment to a pledge, thou shalt deliver unto him by the time the sun goeth down. Talking about the poor. You don't take from the poor. Notice, we have created problems. We should have been the one to set up the check cashing places in the city. Because we allow the check cashing place to rip off poor people, and we do nothing about it. Even now the government is saying that they need to clamp down on these places because they are scourged to the city. But we said, no, that's not our focus. So at this point now, I'm going to try to get this off in the next few minutes, this thought. At this point, somebody might be thinking, how about the three-angel message? Isn't that our focus? Are you saying that we should not be focused on the three-angel message? How about that? Yet we notice that in the reading of the history of Ellen G. White and the pioneers, the end result of these messages, the three-angel message, was a broad work, broad writing, and ministries. So I'm going to just make you think with me here. What I'm preaching here is not for you if you don't want to think, but if you want to think with me here a second. Think about the end result of Ellen G. White work. The focal point of Ellen G. White work, first start with our writings. Is the focal point of Ellen G. White writing only the Pope? Because some people, that's the focal point of the ministry. How many books she talk about what's going on in the Vatican and stuff like that? How many books she wrote? Off your mind. One, you can know, right? The Great Controversy. But she has many books. Why didn't she just talk about that topic like some of these crazy fanatics? Because I call them fanatic creators. All they talk about every week. The Pope did this. Think about it, one book. Why didn't she just do that, because they say they're getting this from the three angel message. I'm going to show you that they're false. The three angel message does not teach what they're doing. But yeah, think about it. One book. All of the books deal with all the various different subjects that we talk about here. Can you see that? Naturally, all these things you can find in our writings. But yet, they make their ministry at the one subject is religious liberty. And everything else they ignore. Think about it, our writing. It's all over the place. Read the Bible. The Bible is all over the place when it comes down to human problems and woes. Then the next thought you to think about with me here is think about the broad work. The main focal point of work, raising churches, setting up sanitariums. Look, there was more restaurants that Adventists owned when Ellen G. White was alive than now. I don't know if you can count on one hand how many even decent restaurants. I must say you can't even eat at these restaurants. Food so bland, tastes bad. So restaurants, sanitariums, the hospital work that we end up converting from, it was focused on lifestyle. Now we made it focus 100% on medicine, keeping people alive by emergency means on a daily basis. Then you think about orphanages and all these different things. Where are they at now? Zero. We have rebelled totally against the Bible and against what the spirit that led the church to do. Rebel totally against it. We don't do it. How many orphanages? How many? We have probably a few. I know of probably one or two homes for the elderly. And it's not even homes. They're done in conjunction with the government. What? What is there? ADRA? We weren't even supposed to do ADRA. We're supposed to do local-based charity work, but, you know, helping the poor, relief. We're supposed to do local benevolence. Churches in areas deal with the local problem. This is why when ADRA don't even do certain works anymore. They've just aborted certain work. You want help for the poor? They don't do it. No, forget about it. What else? Educational work, we're shutting down the schools and the institutions. Almost all of our colleges have become liberal arts colleges. We've turned away our backs from, you know, any type of manual training, anything like that, anything natural. All we do is just doctors, nurses, and some other things. And, cartoonists for Walt Disney. We produce some of the best cartoonists for Walt Disney. So we can corrupt the minds of America with the foolishness, with the daydream. Where is the work? Think about that's the natural result of the three-angel message. So how's somebody gonna tell me, say, oh no, the three-angel message is telling me that I must talk about the Pope all the time. But when they accepted the three-angel message, they saw that everything that the devil was doing, we need to counteract it. That's the three-angel message. I'll show you in a second. And lastly, here before I go to the last two texts before we close off here, ministries. Look at the ministry that they developed. Look at the ministry now that are here. Almost all of our ministries are talking ministries. We don't do natural ministries anymore. We just preach. Every ministry, you think about all the major multi-million dollar ministries that are out there. All they do, they talk. They're not out there opening up orphanages and do stuff like that. They're not interested in that type of stuff. What they're interested in is just to talk, to print. And the main thing the ministry does is the guy that stands where I'm standing right now. And that's the focal point of the ministries. They don't do health work. They don't do none of that type of stuff. Because they just like to talk and collect millions and buy big cameras. So, Revelation chapter 14, verse 6, our three-angel message, our most one of the most precious messages in the Bible because it's the closing message. Look at this real quickly, and look at the natural reading of Revelation 14, verse 6 onward. You can see why the churches are off their walls when it comes on to what's going on. Verse 6 says, and I saw the angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting what? Gospel. So that's the first part. That's why I say salvation first. The gospel. The gospel is the good news of Christ dying for us to save us. Amen. To preach unto them that dwell on all the earth, to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. Saying with a loud voice, fear God. This is the basic message of Proverbs. Fear God and give glory to Him. So this is where children become focal of the message. Educational work. For the hour of His judgment, the second coming and the judgment hour. And worshiping that made what? The heaven and earth, the sea, and the fountains of water. Notice here, that's where we come into the Sabbath, where we come into the creation message, where we come into who God created and whatever. It brings us back to the first six chapters of the Bible. Verse 8, and therefore another angel said, Babylon the great is fallen, that great city, because you have made a nation drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Notice, the wrath of her fornication. Babylon has fornicated, they have an illicit relationship, and they've made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now, what is that? Is that only religious intolerance and the Sabbath, or is it more? See, that's the question. See, this is where people have missed that one sentence right here. This. Oh, sorry, not on the board. I forget that says my PowerPoint is the full point is not there. I thought the text was up on the board. So it's in your Bible, verse 8, and the end point of verse 8. Because you have made all the nation drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. What is the wine of the wrath of her fornication? Is it one sin? Is it one sin? Everything. Is everything. So how can you say if my focal point is a three-angel message, my focal point is only one thing? It has to be a much broad work that we have to do. And verse 9, and then we go to verse chapter 18. And a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive the mark in his forehead or in his hand, and we stop right there. So this is the mark. Notice the practical evil result of the doctrine, or the false doctrine, and also the practical result of true doctrine. Because Babylon has accepted certain false doctrine, there are certain false results. Babylon say the priest should not marry. What's the end result of the priest not marrying? A lot of little boys, little girls getting raped, right? So we are pro-marriage. We are pro-successful marriages. We are pro what God is pro. Amen? Male and what?
Female.
Adam and Eve. We are pro that. But the end result, you think about this, say a lot of homosexuals are born homosexual, but yet we find the major homosexual areas in America are major Catholic areas. In San Francisco, one priest molested or sodomized over 250-something known cases. These are people came forward and said, he sodomized me. And yet we find in those areas, it's a massive homosexual communities. Where the homosexuals are in big areas, normally it's a big Catholic presence. The priests were sodomizing little boys left, right, and center. It is not just this concept of born. It was put upon a society. What is our work? That's an intimation of what they're doing. Whatever they're doing that the devil is having them do, we are trying to outdo it. We're trying to stop it. Or we're trying to remedy it or try to help. Put some ointment in the wound of the people who are abused. If they have gone, you think about the major Catholic presence in places like Chicago and stuff like that. What's happening? What was the end result of that? The falls would, you know, like I give you an example, Adventist and Catholicism, Catholic. Charity, how do you do charity? You don't teach a man to fish. You just keep feeding him, feeding him, feeding him, feeding him. What do? You create Chicago. This massive woman, because who you give, the policy. The policy is you give the woman the money. The guy can't come to the house, because if he come to the house, he has to assume responsibility for the female. So what the guy do, just slip through the window, impregnate the female, and then disappear. Who is responsible for the kids? The state. The state is not into building families. The state is into keeping those black people there secular and separate. So who is building? But that's false charity. See, true charity is saying, you're the man, you take care of the family, we're going to help you. We're going to spend our billions of dollars retraining you. Send you back to high school. Send you back into training institution. Get you some work. And we're going to put you to labor so you can take care of the family. False charity is just, here the money, here the money, here the money. Kids get the money, kids get the money. Mother get the money. The guy don't have a job because you pull all the jobs out of Detroit, out of Chicago, out of Camden. So there's no job and there's guys. So what the guy's doing, and the guys have urge to have sex because that's what guy's going to do. So there's going to be kids. Who's going to take care of those kids? The government. The kids are going to be a wreck because they're in the system. It's a wicked system, but it's false charity. Who's the master of false charity? The Catholic system. Every evil they do, we are trying to undo it. True pen, true voice, true work. But we have walked away from that work. We were told that we were supposed to work especially for what group of people in America? The blacks, because they were the most oppressed. That's what Ellen G. White says. Did we do that work? We didn't do it. I look at the blacks still oppressed, the most oppressed people in America. They have been had the boots of the people in America, the upper class in America, on their necks, and they can't because they're left in ignorance. And most of them, they're on the charitable system. Give, give, give. Oh, we're not helping. We're making them worse, we're making them lazy. But we don't touch it. Why we don't touch it? Because many of the leadership is racist. That's why I believe. Now, verse chapter 18. We see if we can close out on this here now. Closing in this chapter 18. I'm going to take some points here. And you're going to notice in chapter 18, we'll close out in this idea here. And in the evening, we pick it up in a discussion Bible study. I'm going to show more in the evening. A natural reading of the Bible, and that the Bible is focused on these topics, these issues. The Bible is not just focused on this issue. This is a issue. Right now, the people are dying from these things, and we only talk about this. Because you know what? It makes us feel religious and comfortable. And it makes those that are in charge and have the money, they feel like, oh, I'm doing something profound. And I see their packed halls, packed churches. And this is all they focus on. While outside of the churches, people are dying in need. And they will not spend a dollar. Because they're evil. Chapter 18, verse 1 onwards. So verse 4, read. Notice here now, this is the third angel message. It's a message that is for our time. The three angel message was more so for their time. The three angel message is boost, not remove, but boost. Because of the message of Revelation chapter 18. And verse 1 says, and after these things, so a time has passed. Ellen G. White in the book, Great Controversy, Final Warning, explains this, that a time has passed, and after the time, then the message comes with great power. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. You understand why the earth is lightened with the glory? It's a message of righteousness by faith. What I'm preaching is righteousness. We need to do right. Amen. We need to do right. We ain't doing right. We're playing church. I'm going to tell you, almost every church I've been to, the focal point is grace and worship. Silliness. While people are dying all around them that need some grace. 2 says, and he cried with a mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the Great is fallen, is fallen. That's a repeat of the message, Revelation chapter 14. And has become a habitation of devils. That means if you want to go to church, you go there and find the devils. One of the devils I always see in the church is the choir director. A man that is a homosexual, leading the choir, with his back turned to the audience, dancing in front of other men. The churches are filled with these devils. You go to the, and it's, the Sunday churches are out of control. These guys know to dance.
And a whole of every fall what? Spirit. People that ain't to be no church, they're members of the church. Up in the pulpit. And a cage of every unclean and hateful bird, you find it in the church. You name it. Every thief and con man and ripoff artist. And they call themselves prosperity gospel preachers. They ain't no shame. They just go to church and just tell you, I'm here about money. I'm not following no Lord Jesus. Bring it. And verse 3. Notice again this clause here. For all the nation have drunk of the wine of the wrath of, or what? Fornication. So again, notice here, all the nations. But the difference this time is the next thing it says. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. Not just the local church. Because in Revelation 14, and if you think about Ellen G. White's preaching, their focal point in the pioneer time was what was going on in the church. Not the Catholic Church, as a matter of fact. The focal point, because remember I asked the question before, what is the focus of Ellen G. White writing? One book on the Pope. And he doesn't talk about the Pope, he talks about all churches. But their focal point was not the Catholic Church, because remember at the time the Catholic Church received a deadly what? Wound. So it was not the main issue in her day. Her day, the main issue was what was going on in which churches? The Protestant churches. Was not the Catholic Church. People misunderstand most of her reading, think she's talking about the Catholic Church. Most of the time she's talking about the Protestant churches of which country? The United States. She's talking about what's going on in America. Because she said that America is the country to focus on. And this was before America was the greatest nation on the face of the planet, or was just becoming the greatest nation. So we notice here, the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. So now, the evils that the Protestant churches and the Catholic Church are doing is not just affecting the church people, it's affecting the kings, similar to the Dark Ages again. And the merchants of the earth have waxed rich to the abundance of her what? Delicacy. And I heard in a voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sin, and that you receive not of her plague. We see here now from this point onward, a few more minutes here, that from this point onward, keep forgetting it's not on the board. From this point onward, everything in Revelation 18 focused on merchandising. This is why, for the most part, Adventism can't understand what's going on, because it's all about money and control of people. And so it says here, so notice practical evils and you have the good. While they are merchandising drugs and alcohol, what are we doing? We're teaching people to get off drugs and alcohol. We're helping them through rehab and various different ways to get off the drugs and alcohol. While they're trying to get people into poverty, we're trying to help people get out of poverty. We're saying, hey, go back to school, make some more money, save, don't buy as much as you can, live humbly, follow Jesus. Amen. The, you know, cash is king. You know, the person who borrows is that slave to the person who is the lender. We're teaching a different message because we're trying to help. While they're creating educational system that keep many people poor and fall into the system, we're trying to open school to make sure that these kids graduate and these kids become the head and not the tail. We're working, everything they're doing, we're doing the opposite. We're not going along. We're not trying to open up liberal arts colleges to make buffoons of people. We're trying to open up places that these kids become the head and not the tail. Total different focus. And I say this because I'm out of time, because I notice here that verse 9 again repeats the same concept. And the kings of the earth, that means the political system, the governmental system, the whatever system is in cahoots with the false system, have committed fornication and live how? Deliciously. The rich people are not rich because they work hard. Don't make any crazy politician, no Donald Trump, nobody tell you that. They're not rich because they work hard. If you want to build a stadium in any city across America, you're subsidized by the government. It's taxpayers' money, because you can't build the underground railroad or train, to the subway, to get the people to you. You can create the transportational hub that is critical for a stadium. It's the taxpayer have to do that. A lot of the, you're going to get tax break. If you go out there hoping to have a business today, you're not getting a tax break. But those rich people are going to get a tax break. All of this stuff is happening, and all that infrastructural work is mostly where the money. And then, who is going to be employed? It's going to be the poor people that lives in the city. That they failed in their education. The educational system failed. This is why almost all these new stadiums are built where black people are living. And they're going to be there working the concession stands. And what they told the taxpayer is that we're giving jobs, we're bringing jobs. What kind of jobs? $8 an hour job. It's a failure. We're supposed to be there saying, we're going to help you because your government has failed you. Because you know what the government is in cahoots with these mega church pastors. It's in cahoots with the Pope. And we're going to be there to help you. This is what we're about. But we have walked away from the word because all we wanted to do is talk about some, if somebody do a sign. This is losers. All right. The great city Babylon. And finally here, verse 12 through 14, we close here. The merchandise of gold, silver, and precious stones, of pearl, and fine linen, and purple, and silk, and scarlet, and fine wood, and all manner of ivory, and all manner of vessels of precious wood, and of brass, and of iron, and marble, and cinnamon, and odors, and ointments, and frankincense, and wine, and oil, and flour, and wheat, and beasts, and sheep, and horse, and chariots. And we pause there for a second. Notice all of this is merchandising. The merchandising is structured around making a rich richer. You go to Walmart and any of these stores, it don't matter Macy's, JCPenney, it don't matter where you go to. You know what happened? There's poor people working for 10 cents an hour making that stuff. Why are they working for 10 cents an hour? Because their government is in cahoots. Why the government is in cahoots? Because the church is in cahoots. Somebody said, where are you getting that from? Notice that all the major deals that has happened, the church has approved it. When Cuba opened up, who opened up Cuba? It was Obama and the Pope. All the time, the pastors are at the table. And they're getting their cut. Because many times they want to go into those countries and set up churches to be collecting point. And, you know, it's called rice Christianity. They give you rice, you come to church, you pay me tithe. Who's winning? Wickedness, what's going on. But notice in verse 13 again. How does it close? Slaves and souls of men. Many of these pastors have sold their members out to hell to get rich. You go into a church, you see 10,000 people going to hell. The pastor sold them down of the prosperity gospel. They're just there as a collecting point to collect money. And look at many of these churches. Almost all of these mega churches are in areas where the places is destitute. Poor areas in Atlanta, in Texas, in Florida, in all these areas. And these members just come in there with a hope and some money. Hoping as if they keep paying and they keep giving, the Lord will bless them, and they're still poor. Because that was never the intention of the gospel and the work of the gospel. I'm preaching, you're not doing better, shame on me. I failed. If you have not improved every aspect of your life, my ministry is a failure. And those pastor ministry are a failure because guess what happened? The people are not improving. If you go through a year and you have not improved, I've failed, or you're not listening, you're sleeping in the church. Right, you're sleeping in church. Because there's no way what I'm preaching here, if you're not improving, if your brain not start turning over, you'll fail or I'll fail, but somebody fail. But there's no two ways about it. There's no C answer. It could be a C, but I can't think about the C. There's A or B. Last two verses here. And the fruit that thou so lusted after are departed from thee. And all the things which were dainty and goodly are departed from thee, and thou shalt find them no more at all. The merchants, notice here, the businessmen are in cahoots with the pastors. The merchants of these things which were made rich by her stand afar off for the fear of her torment, weeping and wailing. Why? Because they're all gone. God is not joking. You see what happened? I remember I said this example just to show why I say God's not sleeping. I remember back in the 80s, I've said this before, it had been proven that President Reagan paid money for reporters to go into the black communities and report upon the crack epidemic. But historically, and naturally, they have proven that says whites use crack more than blacks. But they only reported on the blacks using the cracks because they wanted to justify racist people in America that it was okay to denigrate and destroy the black community. So what happened? All these years and decades, they were not policing in the white community. Remember, whites were proven to use crack more than blacks. So the problem of drugs got out of control in the white community. Now what's happening? The major areas now where there's drug overdose is in all white communities. And where is it coming from now? A tougher drugs. They've graduated from the crack, they've graduated and they've gone to the opiates and they've gone to the heroin. So now you have a full-scale problem. That now everybody's saying now we need to decriminalize because we can't now be locking up whites as we used to lock up blacks. because we created the military, the prison industrial complex on the back of black men. Who were supposed to be there helping? We were supposed to be there. But what we did, we quiet. I never heard a sermon about this in church. They never touched the issue of drugs and alcohol, yet it's replete through the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. Lifestyle disease of drug, it's a scourge to our society. And I don't care if it's black or white, but we didn't touch it. And because we didn't touch it, now the white families now are losing their kids. Before it was the black families only. Now the whites are losing their kids. We all losing our kids because we didn't help. We didn't do anything about it. And so what happened now? Maine, Vermont, New Hampshire, West Virginia is number one. Number one for the drug epidemic when it comes down to heroin and opiate. Number two, Tennessee, Washington State. Those places are being wrecked. And what do we say? Our focal point is we need to talk about religious intolerance. Why are we having our young people dying and we refuse to lift the hand? But God is not sleeping. And God says you raise up a people that will do the work. And I believe that we are some of those people by God's grace. We endeavor to be those people. So with that in mind, remember at 5:30, we're going to come back around. I'm going to go through some more texts. I want to show you the natural focus of the Bible. The Bible is not focused as all these major crazy ministries that are out there and churches. They don't talk about what's going on in society. They don't help their own fellow men. We want to be those people who help. So we're going to come back at 5:30 and we're going to finish part two. We'll go through some more and we're going to have some discussion. So at this time, we'll sing hymn number 308 to close. We'll sing hymn number 308 to close. Thanks.
Let the congregation rise as we turn to our closing hymn, number 308. 308. I would be, dear Savior, wholly thine. Teach me how, teach me how. I would do thy will, O Lord, not mine. Help me now. Holy thine, holy thine, this is my vow. Holy thine, holy thine, O Lord, just now. What is worldly pleasure, wealth or fame, without thee, without thee? I will leave them all for thy dear name. This my wealth shall be. Holy thine, holy thine, holy thine, this is my vow. Holy thine, holy thine, O Lord, just now. As I cast earth's transient joys behind, come thou near, come thou near. In thy presence all in all I find, 'tis my comfort here. Holy thine, holy thine, holy thine, this is my vow. Holy thine, holy thine, holy thine, O Lord, just now.
At this time, we're going to close with prayer and then we'll have fellowship. Dear Heavenly Father, hallowed be thy name. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you again for your word. We know, dear Heavenly Father, you specifically stepped down from the throne of heaven to come to this earth for a specific purpose, and that is to straighten up the crooked ways. Dear Heavenly Father, we have seen and we've read thy work. From time to time, we have understood a little and other times a lot. But dear Heavenly Father, as we go closer to the end of time, we know that we have to understand a lot, and we have to see the Bible as it is written and how you ministered. We've come from being the people of the book of your word to now a people who have gone astray and have committed terrible sins. We know, dear Heavenly Father, you have faithful people here still in this Adventist church, and you also have faithful people outside that fold. But dear Heavenly Father, we know that there's a tremendous amount of work. We need to pray for workers to join us. We have to ourselves leave sin behind. We ourselves cannot be part of the problem, but a solution to the problem. So we ask the Heavenly Father that, that we really make a decision as to what we need to do. And we thank you, dear Lord, for this church. We thank you for the words that we hear on a weekly basis. And we thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for instilling in us a strong faith. And we know that the work is not easy. It's going to take a tremendous amount of effort. But we know, dear Heavenly Father, that things can happen if you have a faithful people who desire to seek thee and to follow you and to hasten thy coming. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, again for thy blessings today. We pray that all may be satisfied with coming here and be happy when they leave. And we ask thee, Lord, that at this time we're going to, can you bless the fellowship now, the food, and getting to know each other well. We thank you for visitors and friends, members coming here, and those that are listening online. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for this blessing, and we thank you for your word again. In Christ I pray. Amen.